I got to tell you, I don't know what it is, Scott. I think you started crying up here, and I feel like it's Cry Sunday. You know, we have yes days and no days, and I think we have Cry Sunday. We have Cry Sunday. You know, when you do, when you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, it's powerful. And when you begin to sense the heart of God that He has for us and that He has for people, okay, I'm God's heart for you and God's heart for me and God's heart for those that are outside of these walls, it is overwhelming. It's absolutely overwhelming. Today is Pentecost Sunday, and that's a great thing, you know. This is our birthday. It's just the church's birthday. And you need to know what you're a part of, and you're a part of a movement that has stretched out for over 2,000 years that is birthed by God. It was birthed in the day of Pentecost when God poured out His Spirit. It wasn't a surprise, but it came suddenly. Jesus had been talking about it for a while. He'd been telling His disciples about it. But as it goes with the things of God, how many of you know that sometimes these things happen in unexpected places and unexpected ways, and it's only after you look back and go, whoa, what was that, that you can really begin to catch the magnitude of what God was up to? Are you following with me? I mean, that's how I've experienced it so many times in my life, where you can try to make something happen, you can try to strive for something, but when God is at work and when His Spirit is poured out, it happens suddenly, all at once, and it is, oh my gosh, Joanne McClellan. What? Hi, Joanne. Sorry, I just had to say it. You talk about a suddenly. Sheesh. Wow, it's so good to see you. Okay, so back to this. I don't know, let's just have a party now. Let's hang out with Joanne. How are we going to preach a sermon now? Oh, anyways, this morning, I love it when this kind of thing happens. You know, I woke up, and the first thing, like as I was waking up, you know, I just sensed the Lord speaking to me, and I love that. You know, you can wake up with fear, you can wake up with anxiety, but when you wake up with peace and just like the whisper of the Lord, man, that is so cool, isn't it? And I tell you, I think you probably are like me. You've woken up with all three of those things. And this morning, though, I just woke up with this sense of peace and this just little whisper from the Lord. And this is what I felt like God said. It says, and what I put on my paper was, the sense that I had is that God is saying, I pour out my Spirit so that you can spill out my Spirit. And I was just kind of sitting there just mulling that over. And I had been studying the night before and throughout the week about the Holy Spirit and this outpouring of God's Spirit in the second chapter of Acts. But the idea of how generous God is, that I pour out, like I pour. Just get in your mind that idea of what pouring is. It's not I trickle or I turn the tap on just a little bit, but I pour. It's so generous. It's so abundant. I pour my Spirit out so that you can spill it out. You know, because who does He pour onto? He pours onto His church. And what He pours out fills us so much that I think it's Bob Goff that says it, or some author that I've read recently, that we leak Jesus, you know? It's like we're leaking Him, that it's coming out of us. And the difference between a church that is pouring out or is that spilling out Jesus as they've been poured into, or one that's trying to spill themselves out is huge, okay? When we try to spill of ourselves and we try to make things happen on our own, or when we strive towards trying to be relevant or any of the above, whatever category that we try to do in our lives, it's really obvious to everybody and it's not authentic. But when you receive from the Holy Spirit the virtue, the life of the Spirit, and it just flows out of you, it's unmistakable that it's God and not you. You are somehow this earthen vessel, right, that it speaks about in the Word of God, and that what comes out of you is God unmistakably. And so I hope that today, as we look into some scripture, that you'll just rest knowing that the only response to pouring is receiving, right? You don't have to go, where's the well? You know, where's the spring? It's that God's pouring upon His church is so vast and so generous that the only response is to receive. And so you're in for a treat today if you want to receive. So Pentecost, it just means 50, it from the word penta. And what it in the Jewish feast, it was 50 days after Passover you would celebrate this. But for us as Christians and throughout the world today, 50 days after we celebrate the resurrection of Christ, we remember what He did when He birthed the church. And as I already said, it wasn't a surprise, but it happened suddenly. Jesus had been talking about it. You no matter what, around this subject and this topic of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you always run into different viewpoints. You know, man throughout the centuries has categorized what God does. It's called theology. Okay, whose phone's ringing? Just raise your hand. Come on. I'm just kidding. Bagpipes? Is it Maggie? Oh! Manner mode, people. Come on. Manner mode. It says it right on. I'm just teasing. We're fine. Your phone is fine. There is therefore no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. It's all good. Oh, as I was saying, though, that we take and we categorize controversial things, and certainly whenever there's movement of the Holy Spirit, it becomes controversial. And so there's various camps. There's the camp that says that this was a one-time event that occurred, and after the Bible was completed, the canon of Scripture, the perfect has come, so to speak, then those things that happen, those manifestations of God's gifts ceased at that moment in time. That's one camp. Then there's a camp on the far other side of that camp that basically says, no, it's all happening right now all the time. And I don't know, that doesn't really sound like the far other side, but I think sometimes that far other side can be associated with like circus-like activity, you know, things that cause people to want to stay away from, like, oh, are you one of those Holy Spirit, Holy Roller, Pentecostal swinging off the chandelier kind of places? You know, we had a bad experience with you guys in the 70s. We're not going to do that. And so there's like all these extremes that we can run into. And certainly we strive to be those that walk in balance, but it's kind of hard to be balanced with something so generous as the Holy Spirit, you know? And so you have to ask yourself the question, if that pouring was for one time, or is God still pouring out today? And I'll just cut to the chase. Like, I think God's still pouring out today. I think my conclusion and my stand was that the water is alive, okay? The water is alive. It's living water. Living water doesn't die. I don't ask myself the question, is God still pouring out his Spirit today? I just kind of think it never stopped. It never stopped. The water is alive. So the generosity of God by his Spirit, he continues to pour out and resource his church to do the work of the Spirit. What we do with what we receive of the Holy Spirit is a matter of our own stewardship. And what we create as our own theology once we've received it is a matter of our own really understanding and discernment. Those are separate subjects. But the fact that God generously pours, he has never stopped. And the water is alive. And so you can kind of look throughout history and recent history. I jotted down a few notes of some names that might trigger into your mind. Guys like Smith Wigglesworth of the 19th century. What a cool name, man. You put that out in lights. Wigglesworth, you know, come see Wigglesworth preach, you know. But Smith Wigglesworth, a revivalist, no doubt, and one whose ministry was marked by signs, wonders, and miracles, and you read about Smith Wigglesworth, and you're like, really, man, you did that? You know, the things that he felt compelled of the Holy Spirit to do and empowered to do, and the things that God did. He was one that would say in a room like this, okay, if anyone in here has any kind of ailment whatsoever, you will be healed today. Raise your hand, tell me what it is, and you will not leave this place without a healing. And whether he had to punch you in the face to get it or kick you in the gut or throw you out of the room, he was going to do whatever it took because he was so convinced of the power of the Holy Spirit that had been poured into him that was intended not just for him to go, wow, I got the Spirit, I got it. It was in him in order to leak out and spill out into others. And so history records all this stuff. And every time you record any or you read the record of history, you see dramatic outpouring Spirit, awesome stuff, and like loads of controversy. Okay, so I'll just put that in there. So the second one is Jonathan Edwards, 18th century. Jonathan Edwards, this guy just, he was known as a spiritual man, right? And when I mean spiritual, he loved to listen to God. It would say that he would ride his horse into the forest and he would just spend time trying to listen to what God said, and he would write it down and he would pin it all over his shirt because he would just write it down and, like, I got to remember that. And so he'd come back in on his horse just like riding back in with like post-it notes all over him of what God said so he could go back and put it together and do what the Lord said. And out of his ministry came the same types of things. The Wesley brothers, these revivals that would sweep through the land, that God visited his people in a unique way for a unique time. And the result of it was people's hearts burned with conviction. They wanted to get free of the sin and that they had. They wanted to receive Jesus. And so it generally, these revivals took place with some signs, wonders, miracles, conviction, Holy Spirit, repentance of sin, and salvation, right? Do you know this? And so this was way back in the day. And then you start to think about early 20th century things that happened. Azusa Street Revival. This was just celebrated recently at the Coliseum, the anniversary of the Azusa Street Revival. It was funny, Rochelle and I, we went to look at the pews and to hand over the check for the restored pews. Aren't you happy you're going to have pews? You wanted pews, okay? You got pews. And so we looked at this place, and it happened to be in Azusa, right? And so I was like Googling. I'm like, sweet, I want to check the Azusa Street Church while we're there. And so we got there. We looked at the pews. They look fantastic. I mean, they look like brand new. These guys just stripped them down to nothing, and then they put them all back together, and it's all brand new wood. And you sit in it. It's like, man, if you guys are half falling asleep ever during a sermon now, I'm like, oh, great. You're just be like sitting back in there, putting your feet up. It turned out great. But on the way out, I found the address. I think it's 216 Azusa Street, you know, and I said, let's go check out the place where the Azusa Street Church was. There was two places, two addresses. One was in Bonnie Bray Street. That was the house where it all went down. But then that movement grew, and I'll talk about that movement in just a minute. But it grew, and then it came to a church. And guess what? We kept looking and looking, and then we finally find the address, and we see a medical building. We're like, nah, it can't be. And then we check the address again, and it's a dialysis center now, right? And so we walk in, we're like, well, let's just go in anyways. And we see if we can get some of that, like, Azusa Street revival on us, you know? So we walk in, and the girl's like, can I help you? And we said, I think my wife was the one that said, do you know what this place used to be? And she's all, no. And she's like, you should Google it. And so she was checking out the address, and we go, it used to be like this really important, special church. And then she said, really? She goes, you know, I think I've heard that before. So she sure enough went on there and started checking Google for it and everything else. But the whole point is this: nothing special happened, by the way. I mean, we didn't like see an angel or anything crazy, but it yeah, we didn't tap into any dialysis, anything like that. But what it was for me, I can say, is it helped me associate a geographic location to something that really happened, and it really occurred. And the evidence of this man, Pastor Seymour, right? He was an African American man, and during the segregation, Jim Crow law, all these things that society was saying you can't do, the Holy Spirit broke every barrier. Broke the barriers between men and women, between black and white. And I'm going to read to you, I found this article about it, about the revival from an LA Times reporter. And it's kind of funny when you read it. It's funny, sad, really. But this is what he says. Disgraceful, the intermingling of the races. The cry, they cry and make howling noises all into the day and night. Their preacher, who stays on his knees much of the time with his head hidden between the wooden milk crates. He doesn't talk very much. At times we can hear him shouting, "Repent!" And he's supposed to be running the thing. This is a quote. They repeatedly sing the same song, "The Comforter Has Come." This movement really took place when this pastor who... I just want to weep when I think about it, that here, you know, here's somebody who had to sit on the porch outside of the church, right? How he understands the empowerment of the Holy Spirit and receives teaching about the Holy Spirit is that he graciously sits outside of the church while all the white people are inside of the church learning. And he listens and he learns and he gets some mentoring from the very pastor who allowed that segregation to happen. I don't know how it happened, and I don't want, whatever. It's terrible. And so as he understands this, and then an opportunity comes for him to start this little church in LA, and so he says yes to it, and then God shows up in his generosity. And the least likely person for society in that moment in time, God just goes, phew. And this guy just basically, as we read about him, on his knees with his head between milk crates, probably going, oh my gosh, I can't believe this is happening. People are howling and all this craziness, and there's reporters here. Oh, repent. You know, who knows what's going on in his mind? But what spawned from this little house on Bonnie Bray Street turns into a church that is purchased, that used to be a stable or something like that, that turns into a global movement of Pentecostalism. It's crazy. They start writing a paper, and these papers are published and sent all throughout the world. And from that place, ministers are sent throughout the world, and denominations are formed as a result. And guess what? A ton of controversy is connected to it. So then I started thinking about the 1970s and 1980s. Some of you had experienced some of these movements, and I started thinking about the Vineyard movement. And I think when I was in high school, I remember I got a cassette tape of the Vineyard, and I put it in the Nissan Maxima that I always talk about, right into that cassette. And as I began to listen, it was like the music, you could really feel the Holy Spirit as they sang the songs. It was different than anything I'd experienced before. Something was up with that music, you know, and it wasn't just the music, but it was this movement that had happened, and it had happened as a result of God graciously visiting Southern California and choosing the least likely people to start this crazy movement. Bunch of hippies. You know, that God chooses counterculture people, people who didn't want to connect with the traditional church. And all of a sudden, over here, just right down the 55 freeway at Calvary Chapel, a small church. Did you know Calvary was a small church at one time? Did you know their pastor? Maybe you heard his name. He's on home be with the Lord, Chuck Smith. Did you know he was ready to just throw in the towel? Do you know he was ready to go, why isn't this thing growing? I've done everything. I've been a pastor for like 20 years, and maybe it's time to do something else. And right at that moment, did you know that this cultural movement was happening where the church didn't know what to do with these dirty druggies and, you know, loose moral people, and they didn't know what to do with them, and they're basically anti everything in society. And Chuck Smith, in his own writing, says he couldn't stand these guys. He said they needed to take a shower and get a job. And then his wife says, I just have this heart for them. And she would say to him, can we just drive down to Huntington Beach and watch the hippies? And then she says, let's just pray for them. And they begin this journey of prayer. And then all of a sudden, once get a shower and get a job, are like, oh my gosh, my heart's breaking for these people. And puts out, this is a true story, puts out the word in his congregation, does anyone know a hippie? I'd like to meet one. True story. I've watched them. I've looked at them. I've watched their behavior. Can I meet one? And his daughter happened to be dating a guy, was not a hippie. I'm sure that wouldn't have gone down well. And he picks up a guy hitchhiking with a Bible right here in Costa Mesa. And the guy hitchhiking with the Bible is named Lonnie Frisbee, if you've ever heard this name before. Cover of Time magazine, you know, baptizing girls in bikinis. Like, what, you know? Because it was everyday people being touched by God. Okay, so picks up this guy, Lonnie Frisbee, who had just had this encounter with the Holy Spirit while under the influence of drugs in Taquitos Canyon out in Palm Springs area, and comes from there to Haight-Ashbury, you know, right in the midst of the Summer of Love, comes through that area, gets discipled in Christ, and still kind of working through his own theology. I mean, I'm telling you, this would take some grace for their leadership, because at the same time of believing and really like having this understanding of God's word, believes in UFO and stuff like that, kind of trying to figure out how it all works together. So he had people kind of trying to help him go through that process. And then he leaves that and comes in to meet this guy hitchhiking, and then goes and has a meeting with Chuck and Kay Smith. And they somehow believe that God is at work, and they sense God's spirit at work. And then from there, he says, hey, why don't you come speak at one of our Sunday night things? He does. The place explodes. And a bunch of hippies follow the hippie preacher to the waters of baptism. And God puts together what writers call a football coach type leader. and a hippie to bring people to Christ. And what a great combination of those that I can understand this guy and I need this father in my life. And look at what God did. This was in our time. And some of you are shaking your head. We're like, yeah, I used to go. I know those things. I was baptized at Croto Del Mar or whatever. I mean, this happened. And then tons of controversy woven throughout the whole thing because people are involved. And then right around 1980, in Yorba Linda, it's a Mother's Day service, right? Mother's Day. And John Wimber, maybe you heard that name before. He invites this guy called Lonnie Frisbee to come to a Mother's Day service. And he, John preaches the word, and there's a time of worship. And the reason I know a lot of this stuff, because I wrote a paper on it when I was in school, and I interviewed different ones, guys like Eddie Espinoza and a man named Dennis Evans, who was close with this guy, Lonnie. And so at that service, he begins to John preaches the word, and there's worship, and then he says, I'm going to bring this guy up for a testimony. He shares his testimony. He invites all the young people who are in the congregation to come and stand on the platform. They pray for them, and then he just stretches out his arms and says these words. He says, Holy Spirit, come. And from there, it just went crazy. People just being touched by the power of the Holy Spirit as if there was electricity going through the room. Now, we can read about this and watch videos about it and pick it apart and whatever else. But I, like I said, I spent time with a few people who were there that I respect. And they said, man, it was just such a beautiful display of God's power that I'd never seen before. And I mentioned names and I mentioned people so we understand it happened in real time, in a real context, in a real place with a real God who still wants to pour out. And so we look at that and we look at the results of these two, especially these two in more modern times. And you know what? There are more things that are happening even now, especially globally. But we look at these two movements and the things that happen, one breaking down racial barriers and then the other breaking down structures within churches that at some point in time, what churches had evolved into was almost like an aristocratic thing where, or I don't even know if that's the right word for it, but a structure that said only these people get to do the ministry and all these people who come and sit in the seat, they just get to listen and observe. But the whole breaking of what the Spirit did was, and it was even kind of one of the sayings of the Vineyard movement was, everybody gets to play. And why wouldn't God use somebody like he used to usher in that particular kind of move so that we would understand what Peter meant when he said that we're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, a bunch of weirdos, you know, a peculiar people. That we can show forth the praises of him who brought us out of darkness into this marvelous light. And in that, what I just said, what I just quoted from Peter, there's this term royal priesthood, right? That is extended to all believers through the power of the Holy Spirit, that as royal priests, those who are not like I'm a king priest, but those who are under the lordship of the king and are priests, and every single one of you get to play. And so these movements showed us these things. And so again, hadn't intended to take so much time sharing. I just get a little excited about that stuff. But God began to pour and he hasn't stopped. Let me read to you what Jesus said about his own spirit. And I'm going to give you a handful of scriptures. And then I'm going to read that final account in Acts. And then I my hope today is that what I woke up with this morning, that you'll walk out of the room with. That what you'll walk out of the room with is not, oh man, this is scary and are things going to happen. You know, everything in the Bible that we read about with the movement of the Holy Spirit happens in a context of decent and in order. And it happens, and where there's leadership that is safe before, like that is trusted leadership, there's safety, right? And so I want to put you at ease that I don't have an intention today of making something happen here. The only expectation I have is that you would leave this place filled with more of Jesus and that what is in you will leak out to other people. That's all I desire. So does God still pour out today? He's never stopped. Jesus talks about the Holy Spirit, and I just kind of went through a big picture view of the Gospel of John, and I found something interesting that I hadn't seen before. And we know that the Holy Spirit is talked about in the metaphor of water, right? And it's interesting to me that the very first miracle Jesus does is what? He turns water into wine. He uses this medium of water, and he turns it into wine. And it wasn't just a little bit of wine, all you wine drinkers. It was a lot of wine. It was vats of wine. Do you know that one barrel that they would use would be about 30 gallons, okay? So imagine 30 gallons, and there were six of them. So they were asked to fill six of them with water and to turn that into wine. How many gallons, you math majors? 180 gallons of wine. That was either a big party, a lot of people, or the scripture was trying to show us something, okay? And what I believe the scripture was trying to show us was this picture of generosity, of abundance, of it. This, there is no end to this stuff, okay? There's no end. There's an abundance. So he turns water into wine. We get a picture of abundance. Secondly, if you turn to John chapter 4 and verse 10, one of my favorites, and we talked about this a couple weeks ago, Jesus encounters a woman at the well, and she's at the well doing what she does daily. She's drawing water, right? And it would be it's a pain to do that. You got to walk to the well, draw the water, carry it back. You probably do it multiple times in one day. And so Jesus has a conversation with her, and here's how it goes. Well, basically, he starts the conversation and says, "Give me a drink." And she says, basically, how can I do that? And it goes on in verse 10. It says, Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." Everybody say living water.
Living water.
Verse 11 says, "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep." The well is so deep. "Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave you the well and drank from it himself? As did also the sons and his flocks and herds." And Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become springs of living water, welling up to eternal life." You see, Jesus was, I believe in the Gospels, planting the seeds of understanding of what this Holy Spirit was about. And by the way, the Holy Spirit, we say the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is a person in the terms of how we understand God, Father, and Jesus. And so you have relationship with the Holy Spirit. It's not like a force that goes throughout, but there's the person of the Holy Spirit. And so Jesus is trying to, Jesus didn't create that, or it didn't just, Holy Spirit didn't come in the New Testament. Holy Spirit was there at creation. You know, the Father was there at creation. God is an eternal God, triune, three in one. And so when Jesus is unpacking this for people, it's like he's putting the seeds there. Let me talk to you a little more about it and more about it so that it's not a surprise to you, but it will happen suddenly and you'll be able to understand it. And so the second picture that we get of the Holy Spirit is first the picture of abundance, but second the picture of quenching your soul's thirst. There is something in your soul that is so thirsty that this woman was thirsty. And she was thirsty not with the kind of thirst that we might have from physical drink or lack of. She was thirsty in her soul. She had questions. She was smart. She had things going on in her mind. But the barriers that were there because of the time that she lived in inhibited her from understanding these things until Jesus showed up, encountered her, and began answering her questions, and then left her with a deep well of living water that would never end. And do you know what happened to her, I believe? She got a glimpse of that. Her soul was quenched, right? Do you understand what I mean by that? That it's difficult maybe to understand. It's that there's this hunger in our heart, you know, these questions that we have. And God, do you have answers? And sometimes we don't get the phrasing of the answer to the question, but we get that it is well with my soul. And that our soul is quenched, and that's the Spirit of God. And so this woman, she's filled and she spills. She goes and tells the rest of her village, and we know that there's great salvation that comes. The second thing that I read about was in John 7. So you jump from John 2 to John 4 to John 7. John 7, 37, he begins to get a little more specific about what this living water is all about. Again, they're like clues, like breadcrumbs that are dropped along the way. John 7, he says, "On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, 'If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said," what? "Streams of living water will flow from within him." And if you ever wondered what he meant, it says, by this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up until that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. Okay, again, breadcrumbs along the way. Now we get into John 14. Jump a couple more chapters. John 14, chapter 15. He says this. He's getting close to his time of death on the cross. And he's getting his disciples ready, you know. And what he says to them is, if you love me, you will obey what I command. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor, capital C, to be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be with you. And I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me because I live in you. You will also live. And on that day, you will realize that I am in my Father and you are in me. And I am in you. This again speaks of that. I'm sorry. This speaks of the council of truth, right? Now he begins to talk about the function of the Holy Spirit. That not only is the Spirit refreshment and an endless supply to you, but the Spirit has actual value to you in terms of counsel, constant companionship, and discernment, and helping you to know the truth. And so then this is where he goes on in verse 25. He says, and this I have spoken with you, but the counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things, will remind you of everything I said. And then he says in verse 27, peace I leave you. My peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. Okay, now I'm rushing through this because the last one, John 20. We sang this song today. It's your breath in my lungs, so I pour out my praise. I pour out my praise. You guys like that song? It speaks to me. Like, the language is accessible. I understand what it's saying. I understand it because I understand that in Genesis, what happened when God created mankind, it says that he breathed life into them, right? Just like this picture of breathing life into mankind. The Hebrew word for that breath is ruach, right? And the word of breath is associated with Holy Spirit. In the New Testament, the word is pneuma, right? And the idea is the same. It's like this first birth that you have in your understanding of, you know, your created being. And then God, by his Holy Spirit, breathes this new life into you, this new vibrancy. It's amazing. It's amazing what's being said here. Now listen, it says in John 20, 21, and Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. Okay, now understand the progression. Water into wine, and understanding there's this thirst that only I can quench, and understanding that there's this comfort and counsel that's going to be with you always, and understanding that when I'm talking about water, I mean the Spirit, and then on into 14, there's peace involved with this, and then into 20, I'm doing this for a reason. Disciples, get ready, because I'm about to breathe into you. And so he says, and with that, he breathed on them. And he said, receive the Holy Spirit. And as I was reading that, I was thinking about Genesis, and I was thinking about what it would be like for those disciples and what that breath really meant. And I believe it was like Jesus saying, okay, guys, you're alive. Like everybody go like this real quick, because sometimes I wonder. Okay, you feel something, right? It should be like a thump, 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 thump. You're alive, right? You're alive. You're alive. But then Jesus goes, here's Holy Spirit. Now come alive, right? You're alive here. Now come alive in here. Come alive in your spirit. And I will give you everything you need to spill me out to others. You're a royal priesthood. Okay, so all these things, they happen. And then it goes down big time, right? Jesus ascends to the Father. You have the Acts account, and prior to that, Jesus spends time with the early disciples, and they're just trying to work stuff out and figure out how to run this new movement of the way or Christianity. And then he says, just hold tight, guys. Wait, wait until I come to you with the Holy Spirit. And then in Acts chapter 2, let me read to you what occurs. It says, on the day of Pentecost, when they were together in one place, suddenly a sound like the blowing of violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. And they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. And all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So understand from John, he was just getting them ready, you know, and he was getting people in the place of anticipation. And then the day comes when this generous pouring comes out, okay? It was almost as if the trickles were happening before, and then the bucket, you take a Home Depot bucket, just gets spilling. And then all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And now there were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And when they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, are not all these men speaking Galileans? How is it then that each one of us hears his own native language? Parthian, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judah, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia. And it goes on with a long list of everybody who showed up. Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, what does this mean? Some, however, made fun of them, and they said they have had too much wine. So you have an authentic occurrence of something supernatural going on. And listen, here's the natural response to it. Some people are just like, whoa, I want to know what this is. It bears witness with me. And others are like, what? You're drunk, you know? This is normal activity when God's Spirit shows up. It's just a matter of which one are we going to be. And so here's what it says. Then Peter stood up because, you see, there are counterfeits of the movement of God's Spirit and there's a reality of God's Spirit, okay? And you got to look for a guy like Peter. You got to look for a person who has authority, who's anointed by God, who can say, okay, let me just talk to you straight. I'm not going to give you flowery language and use words that nobody understands, that only a tight circle of people who get it understand. I'm going to use everyday language to show you what's happening right now. In fact, not only am I going to use normal people language, I'm going to use the word of God to show you what's happening. And that's exactly what he does. He stands up with authority and he says, he raises his voice and he addresses the crowd. He could have addressed the cloud. That would have been weird, but he actually addressed the crowd. He says, fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain to you. Listen carefully. These men are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No. This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. It's not a surprise. Not only did Jesus plant the seeds and leave the breadcrumbs, but your prophets have been talking about it forever. And you just can't see it yet. But it's just happened. It happened suddenly. You know, I don't know about you, but some of the most impactful and deep things in my life and my relationship with God, I understand in retrospect, not in the moment. I look back and I go, whoa, what was that? And somebody like a Peter in my life will say, let me explain what's happening. Let me open up the scripture to you. There's so much more. And so then he reads what the prophet Joel is all about. He says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Everybody say all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see vision. Your old men will dream dreams. And even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood, fire, billow of smoke. And the sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. You see, there's so much to talk about, and I really am running out of time. But what I see and what I would point you to is the people who are mentioned there, the diversity of people, everyone. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. It doesn't matter if you're a Parthian or a Mede or however many people were there. It doesn't matter if you were young or you're old. It doesn't matter if you're a servant or a wealthy person. He's saying, my spirit is made accessible to all people all the time. And what you do with it is up to you. It's being poured out generously. It beckons you to accept it and come alive inside. And it's up to you. And it's up to me. And so many of us in this room would say, yeah, I'm with you. You're preaching to the choir. And maybe I am. And maybe I am, but I think on the day of Pentecost, in our celebration of it, we got to come back to the historical truth of what this day was all about. And to me, if I was to put my finger on one thing, yes, there was tongues that were spoken. And I believe in the speaking of tongues. You know, but I don't know that this is the prayer language that we talk about, okay? I think in another portion of scripture, it talks about when I utter a tongue, that in that point in time, I'm praying words that God and I understand, you know? That's what that's about. This is about accessibility. This is about making language, the language of the Word of God, accessible to all people. It's very clear what this one's about. This is about someone literally speaking the wonders of God in another language. That's huge. That's huge. And so while I believe in both, I want to bring us to what this one is about so that we walk out of this room knowing what I believe the Holy Spirit wants to do in unifying the church, unifying the message, you know, unifying and making it available to all people in all times. Does that make sense? And so here's some of the characteristics, and this is what I'll close with. When I read this, I took a step back and I said, what are the characteristics of the outpouring of Pentecost? One, unity. Okay, these people are in the same place, in a place of anticipation. I want to tell you, the enemy's number one pathway to destruction is disunity. You can see it in spiritual things, and you can see it in natural things. If he can disunify, he can divide, he can conquer. Right? We understand it in war. We understand it in companies. We understand it in families. We had better understand it in the church. Because where there's unity, there is power. And God blesses unity. He shows up in powerful ways, and it's amazing. So first thing we see is unity. The second thing I've already alluded to is suddenly. When you're present, okay, there's one thing to be in the room. Some of you are in the room, and others of you are present in the room. Some of you are already on to like, man, okay, good, it's almost done, you know? Others of you are like, come on, give me more. I don't know where you're at. But to be present in times of seeking God, in times of listening to his word, in times of worship, is to be fully there as best as you can. And for those fully there, you're ready for the suddenlies, right? Do you understand what I mean by a sudden? Like, whoa, okay, God just healed someone's arms, you know? As he did with us here, with Amy. Wow, God just touched my heart and just literally removed bitterness from me. And I want to forgive that person. These are works of the Holy Spirit who's alive in us. But you've got to be present in order to recognize suddenlies. And that was a suddenly. The third thing I have as a characteristic was inclusivity. Like everybody, I made up that word because it had a Y on it and fit the others. But it was everybody was included, right? The language included everybody. It was not a holy club in that regard of the haves and the have-nots. And if somebody didn't understand the language, God by his Spirit was going to make that language understandable. And it was language of the glories of God. Amazement. There was amazement that happened there. It was supernatural. And fifth and final was that there were questions and controversy. And so what I leave you with today is hopefully an open heart for one thing, more of Jesus, and an understanding that it comes by way of the Holy Spirit, and with a hopefully refreshment and hope that God wants to pour out into your life. Amen? Amen. Can I have you guys come up, and we're going to end our service. If you would like to stand, there's a song that's become special to me. And in this song, and as they sing it, there's this one tagline, and it says, let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the wonder of your goodness, or something like that. But the part in that song that ministers to me is, I want to be aware of God's Spirit. I want to be present. I want to be there so that I understand the suddenlies. I want to take the bad experiences that I might have had. I want to take those things that are possibly keeping me from knowing him more because of something dumb somebody did or some controlling thing that happened or something that happened in the 80s, the 90s, or last week, that we take that stuff and just push it aside and say, what I know of God's word and what I know of the promise and what I know that Jesus was so excited to talk about and what I know of occurred at one point in time, and if I know this water is living and alive, then I want to drink it to the fullest. And so God, help me to become aware of your Holy Spirit. Amen? All right, let's sing it.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become
as we welcome your presence into the door of our heart, as we begin this time saying that you stand at that very door and you knock, we ask you, Lord, that we would be aware of where you're on the move, what you're doing, and that we would be involved in it. God, we ask you that you would fill us afresh and anew. It seems to me, Lord, as I read your word, that you never said that the water was temporarily alive, but you give us a picture of streams of living water that flow continuously, even Ezekiel's picture of these waters that rise and rise and rise, of an endless supply of all that we need. We thank you for that. And God, with that, we know that your Spirit is holy. And oftentimes when we come near your Holy Spirit, we're aware of our own inadequacies. We're aware of our failures. And we need to repent and to ask your forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us the way and you've shown us how to do that. May we be those that walk in obedience and the full benefits of living free and clear because of what you did, and repent and then receive that forgiveness. But my prayer, God, for each and every one that's here today is a deeper awareness of the power of your Holy Spirit. It seems to me that if the enemy could get us to believe something of a diminished view, that's where we're stuck. But if we have an expanded view of the Holy Spirit, the opportunities are limitless because you are limitless. So would you open our understanding today, not by my words or my lesson in history, but by your words, God, your scripture. May it come alive. Break down every barrier, break down every wall, and Lord, make your word accessible for all people of all times. We thank you for it. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you. If you, this morning, if you would like prayer for anything, please know that we'll be here to pray for you. And God bless you. You guys have a wonderful week. Thank you so much.